So, let's for 1 second don't think about your math exams and let's dive into the beautiful subject of ecology. So, do you have questions?
Of course.
Okay, can I start?
Yes.
But because
I have an idea. Sorry, before you start asking the question. Let's try to move in order and not... So, let's start from... I think lecture 4 we covered everything the last time. I mean, is there any question about lecture 4? Yes! Thank you, ask your question.
That's what I wanted to start, because my question is on lecture 4.
Yes. Before you start, is there any question about lecture 1, 2 or 3?
Okay. I want to understand more about the hysteresis. I couldn't make I couldn't imagine the 3D that you drew.
Oh, I see. Do you mind if I draw only 2D figures to answer? Let's say that is it clear what I draw here? Okay. So let's say that you start from here and you move in this direction, and then when you arrive here you move back. Okay. So I fix k, say it differently, I fix k to a value larger than this value here that we sort of calculated, which is, I don't remember the exact value, but if you follow the notes, you are able to calculate this value. So you are above this Kc. You are above k larger than Kc. And you look at u star as a function of rho. Okay? So there are, let's say there is, let me call this rho. So this is phase 1, this is phase 2, this is phase 3. Let me call this point here rho 1, 2, and this point here, rho 2, 3. Okay? Great. So this is rho 1, 2, this is rho 2, 3. Actually, rho 2, 3, rho 1, 2, let's put a comma because there is no error. Okay? Great. So, below this point, you have one fixed point at a low density. This fixed point loses stability if you keep moving stability here. Then in this region here, you have an unstable fixed point, and here you have another stable fixed point. Okay? Is it clear what this picture represents? So you have in phase 1, so this is phase, so this should be. This is phase 1, this is phase 2, this is phase 3. Phase 1, we have one fixed point at rho abundance. Phase 2, three fixed points, two stable, one unstable. Now let's say that you start here, and you as the experimenter or someone in control of the system can change rho. Okay? So you increase the value of rho. Okay? So what happens to the community? Well, the population of worms goes here. When you arrive at this point, what happens? You jump here, right? Because this fixed point loses stability, and so you go here. So if I add a red chalk, but I don't have it, so you go here, and then you jump here, right? And then you keep going there. Now you arrive at this point here, and then you move back. Right? You move back, and here you use stability. Right? Okay? So this is the typical in one direction or in the other direction, the two paths are different. Right? And the reason why they are different is that you have a region in the middle where you have two stable fixed points, so you have bistable systems, and depending on where you approach, you jump into different points, right? So the fixed point which is that you get when you start from very large row is one of two fixed points, the other one is the other fixed point, and therefore you have this region in between where you are in either of the two. Now, of course, if you have, let's say, stochasticity or disturbance, noise in the system, and you are here, you can jump between these two, right? Because you can cross this peak. Yeah. We haven't seen this, but if you understand why you can cross, good. If you don't understand, it's not important now. But the point is, now we are in fully deterministic regime, so if you do like this, you jump here, and then if you go back, you're going to jump there. This is interesting. Well, I mean, it's interesting by school by itself, but it's interesting because it tells you fundamental issues that you might encounter as someone, for instance, that want to preserve and conserve the biodiversity of the planet, right? Because if you go above this critical transition, then you need to do much more than just go back to what happened before the transition, right? That's the main issue, right? Let's say that this is something I mentioned last time. Let's assume that this is temperature, and let's say that this is like some index of how many species you have. Let's say here is the number of species. We might be in a scenario like this, right? This is temperature, right? Let's say this is the average temperature of the surface of oceans, right? And this is the biodiversity of the whole planet, or the diversity, how many different species of fishes you have in there. Right? So the issue is that we might be here. Right? So let's say that we are here, then you jump here, and then you are here. Right? Now, even if every country in the world joins the Paris Agreement, right? And then you invest a lot in renewable energy, you do all your best, then you're fucked up. Right? Because then you have to go back here. Right? That's the issue. Right? It's a very optimistic plot, as you can see. Right? This is the problem. But as one important lesson is that this doesn't emerge in a very weird, complicated scenario. It emerges in a very simple nonlinear dynamical system. Right? So, well, I mean, you can argue whether we are really in a situation like this, but and what is really on the axis, and where is exactly this point here? I mean, we might be here, we might be there, I don't know. But still, it's something that it's a realistic scenario. Right? I mean, it's also possible that we are here. Let's guess why this is open. Huh? Yeah, no, but I mean, it's because I don't want to put you in danger since I'm speaking loudly. I think it's better to keep it open. I mean, if you want, we can close it and reopen every 15 minutes. But are you freezing?
Not yet.
Okay. Let me know when you're freezing. You are not freezing because you are. Okay. Good. Okay? Great. Any other question on lecture 4? Any question on lecture 5? It's like a bit. What is? You have a question. 5. You have a question. Apparently, you have a question.
Actually, it's about the system of differential equation.
Okay.
Yes. I followed the video, the way you solve it, I didn't really understand because, usually, to study the stability of the system, you have to find the if it's grippies less than zero. But in the video, you talk about the Jacobian somewhere, but I didn't see where you use the eigenvalue to study the stability.
Okay, I'm not sure to which point. I mean, is there a particular equation?
Six,
not
six. Yeah, it's fine.
Yeah,
probably. But okay, I can answer the question because it's also, so. Okay, so you are saying. Let me try to answer because I'm not sure too exactly what. So you say I have like an equation like this. Okay, and I calculate the element j I j, and let's say that I have a fixed point f of x star. This defines a fixed point. I want to know whether this fixed point is stable. So I take the Jacobian matrix whose elements are defined as dfi dxj, okay? And if I want to check the stability of this fixed point, I have to evaluate these derivatives. I think this is your question. I have to evaluate this derivative in x equal to x star, okay? And then I have a matrix that has some values, right, which depends on the parameters, but it's not a function, right? It's not a function of x, it's evaluated in x star. And then I want to calculate the eigenvalues of this, which x star.
The Jacob?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. Now, when we applied this in the example we have studied so far, we have considered only equations that are two-dimensional. Okay. And if you have a two-dimensional matrix, well, let's say that you have Jacobian which is a 2 by 2 dimensional matrix. There is a trick which makes the calculation of the sign of the eigenvalues much faster. And this is what we have used. In principle, you can calculate all the eigenvalues, right? You can solve, I mean, in this case, you can actually calculate them, you can write the characteristic polynomial and find them, okay? Is it clear how to calculate the eigenvalues of this?
Yes.
Okay. But there is a trick, right? Let's say that there are two eigenvalues, lambda 1 and lambda 2. Okay? Now, since this is a 2 by 2 matrix, there are only two scenarios. Right? Either the real part of lambda 1, the imaginary part of lambda 1 is equal, well, since this is a 2 by 2 matrix, the imaginary part of lambda 1 is equal to minus the imaginary part of lambda 2, right? Because if they have, if they are complex, they need to be complex conjugate, and if they are not complex, they are real, then the imaginary part is equal to 0, okay? Great, so this is a necessity. Now, there are two cases, right? If the imaginary part of lambda 1 equal to imaginary part of lambda 2 equal to 0, okay? I know that what is their trace? Well, their trace is lambda 1 plus lambda 2. Okay? And their determinant is lambda 1 times lambda 2. Okay? I mean, this is true in general, actually. So, okay? So if the imaginary part of lambda 1 equal to the imaginary part of lambda 2 equal to 0, okay, then this is the sum of the real parts. Okay, this is the sum of the real parts, and therefore, if I want both of these, if I want to check whether it's stable, so lambda 1 lower than 0, lambda 2 lower than 0, right? Then it's stable. This is true if and only if lambda 1 plus lambda 2 is negative, and lambda 1 times lambda 2 is positive. Right. So if and only if the trace of j is lower than 0 and the determinant of j is larger than 0, okay? I mean, you can check in this direction if this is true. If these are negative, then these two conditions hold. If these are true, this means that they have the same sign. This means that they are both, then they are both negative, okay? So also in the other directions. So this is if the imaginary part are equal to 0, okay? if the imaginary part are not equal to zero, so if the imaginary part of lambda 1 different from zero, okay, then it means that lambda 1 is equal to some lambda, and lambda 2 is equal to lambda transpose, complex conjugate, sorry, okay? So if I check what is the trace, well, if the trace of J in that case is going to be the sum of these two, but the sum of these two is 2 the real part of lambda, okay? And the determinant of J is equal to lambda, lambda complex conjugate, which is always larger than zero. Okay? So it's also true in this case that if this is stable, so if the real part of lambda is lower than zero, if and only if these two conditions are true. Okay? So that means that I can compute the trace and the determinant, which is something that is easy, and check whether these two quantities are, if the trace is negative and the determinant is positive. So I have just to check is if the trace of J is A plus B, and the determinant of J is AD minus BC. Okay? So I have to check whether this condition holds. Okay? So this is what we did in the example we checked. Does this answer your question or no?
It's okay. But in the video, you didn't use this trick. You didn't use this method. You use another method to check this
statistic. Exactly, in which point?
You use mod GIG.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. The expression of GIG in your method.
Well, I mean, I computed these quantities, right? I mean, have you, like, which equation you have in mind? Let's say, not Volterra.
Right.
Which equation you have in mind when we apply these?
I didn't write it down.
Let's say, so for instance, in this case, So your question is, if I have this equation, why the condition for stability is the eigenvalues of this being positive, being negative? Is this your question?
Yes. And you use lambda, something like lambda, exponential lambda, something.
Can I check the point? So it's like why, okay. Let's say that we are in this scenario here, and we have a fixed point, and we want to know whether the fixed point is stable. Okay? So what we do is we define dxi equal to xi minus xi star. Sorry, this is an I. Okay. And then we expand this equation around this close to zero. Okay? So if I substitute this one, this xi is clearly equal to xi star plus delta xi. So I substitute this here, and what I get is delta xi dot equal to fi x star plus delta x. Okay? And then I can write the expansion of this. I get fx star plus sum over I d fi sum over j, sorry, dfi dxj delta xj, but this is in x star, plus sum over jk j delta xk over 2 df I dxj dxk and all the other terms, right? Now, this term here is equal to zero by the definition of fixed point. So this is equal to zero, and this is the leading term, right? So this term is much larger than this term, right? Because I'm considering that this perturbation here is very small. Okay? So then what I get is that delta xi is equal to the sum over j of some matrix jij delta xj, where this is defined as dfi dxj. So this is a linear system of equation, and I know that the system converges to zero if the real part of all the eigenvalues of j is negative, and diverge from zero if the real part of all the eigenvalues is positive, right? Now, I think, well, then you can say, what if the largest real part is equal to zero? Well, in principle, you have to look at the second order, as it happened in the one-dimensional case. Now, I think that the thing that confused you is when I said something like this. I said, well, if the real part of lambda max over all the eigenvalues, the largest real part of the eigenvalue of the eigenvalue of j is negative, then delta xi is something that is exponentially minus, let's call this lambda star, minus lambda star, lambda star. Okay? So it's going exponentially to zero. Now, if this is positive, well, it's true that initially this is going exponential in time, right? But then this becomes big, and therefore the fact that here I'm neglecting all those terms is not true anymore, right? So I'm just saying that if this is negative, it's true that for any large time this is the behavior. If the eigenvalues is positive, the real part of the maximum real part of the eigenvalues is positive, then it's going exponentially away from the fixed point, but only initially, because then there are going to be other terms that are going to play a role and become important. Right? So this, my point is just this expansion here, it's valid only if delta x is small. Of course, if you have an exponential here, this becomes large. So there is a point where that fails. Okay?
When you say the maximum of the real part, that means it can be a function.
No, because J, this J here, I mean, well, J is a function of the parameters, right?
Yeah.
But it's not a, I mean, it's not a function of the state, it's not a function of the variable, it's not a function of x, because this J is evaluated in the fixed point. Okay? It is a function of the parameters, yes.
The real part is a function of parameters.
Yes. I mean, you can, you can ask, when you ask whether a fixed point is stable, you can ask as a function of parameters. Right? And perhaps there are some value of parameters for which that fixed point is stable, stable and others for which it's not. This is equivalent to what we found in a one-dimensional system, right? You can have, you have a fixed point, and that a function of the parameters, but for some value of parameters, that fixed point is not stable anymore. Right? You look like you have a question.
Yes, of course. I always have a question.
So, yes, so any question on lecture 5?
Lecture 5.
Not, we can move to lecture 6. Any question on lecture 6?
First one, the, I don't remember if
it is indicator
6 or 5.
Okay.
But the gamma.
We
7.
No, gamma, there is a gamma also here. There are multiple gammas.
Yeah.
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 This so notation gamma, change lecture from lecture.
We already supposed in the beginning of the lecture that it is less than 1.
No.
Because you just asked, like, give a guess.
Ah! Sorry. Yes. Sorry. I told you give a guess, and yes, the right guess is gamma lower than 1. That doesn't mean that there are scenarios when gamma can be larger than 1.
Because I didn't understand how we jump to the
case. Yes, sorry. I mean, it depends on how you interpret these equations, but I totally agree. I mean, in general, if you think this as competition for resources, you you typically consider the case where gamma, the most natural setting is the case gamma lower than 1. So when the effect of another species on your growth is smaller than effect of your conspecific on growth. And that's because your conspecific eat exactly the same thing that you eat, while they have exactly the same behavior, so they have a maximal overlap with what you do, while not conspecific, it's slightly different things, and therefore they affect less your growth. Right? Now, this is sort of the null scenario. That doesn't mean that that always applies. So that's why it might be interesting also to study the case of gamma larger than 1.
Another one, you...
For instance, I mean, any of you watch, because I always send them to you, any of you watched, I know you had another conflicting lecture, so there was a seminar last week about experimental a guy that does experiments with bacteria, sort of small ecosystems of bacteria with like 2 or 3 species, and basically consider, he has a system where you have, he has 2 species, and it's very cool, these 2 species, basically they interact by modifying the pH. So there is one bacterium, let's say bacterium 1, that likes very much low pH, and there is bacterium 2 that likes very much high pH, right? And they not only like this condition, but they always also change the environment. So if you have like a neutral medium, then you put bacterium 2, which likes high pH, then the pH in the environment is going to become larger, okay? So it's going to become more alkaline. And if you have the other species, species number 1, then the pH is going to go lower and is becoming more acidic, right? Now, it shows that basically you can think that, like these 2 equations describe that scenario if you want with a gamma larger than 1. So you have a bistable system. And the reason is that the effect, having species number 1, it's much worse than having conspecific, right? Because then having species result number one affects the pH in the environment, which you really don't want to be changed, right? It's clear?
Yeah.
Sort of. So that is an example where you don't compete for resources, right? You compete for pH in some sense. And that can be described by this equation.
Yes. The pH here is the number between 0 and 14.
Yes. Okay. But, yes, I mean, one likes, I think, I mean, let's say that you start with pH around 6.5, and one likes as optimal growth around 8, and the other one has optimal growth around, I think, 4. I mean, it's not that you go to super acid. I mean, yeah.
There is another one. In the end of the lectures, one of the videos when you were studying the all possible cases, in the same lecture of gamma,
yes,
you said that in one of the cases, who survived depends on the initial conditions.
Yes, that's the case gamma larger than 1.
Yeah, but I thought all our systems are differential equation,
mm-hmm.
and it's like all the time, any outcome always depends on the initial condition.
Yes. I mean, the point is, what do we say as, what do we consider as outcome, right? The trajectory always depends on the initial condition. The point for large times, so the attractor for large times, which is what actually we care, doesn't depend on all the details of the initial condition, right? So if you are growing logistically, where you're going to go at large times does not depend on the initial condition. If you have these systems of equation with gamma lower than 1, it does not depend on the initial condition. You go to the, if the fixed point exists, you go there. Okay. On the other hand, in that scenario, it depends in the sense that you have two fixed points, you have a bistable system, and if you start with one abundance which is much higher than the other one, you go to one of the two fixed points. For instance, the case of these two bacteria was exactly the same. If you start with much more bacteria of type 1, they like the ones that like acidic environment, you're going to end up in the acidic attractors, where you have only those low pH. In the other case, you're going to end up in the alkali attractor, where you have all the other species. Right? So the attractor depends on the initial condition. And this is because you have a bistable system. This is similar to, I mean, we have seen that also for one-dimensional systems. For instance, when you are here, right? Now this is the fixed point, but suppose that you start from a new, which is this, you end up here, right? If you start here, you end up there. So in this bistable region, where you end up depends on the initial condition. Right? Remember that we drew something like U dot, U, and you have something like this. Yes, so. Oh, this is not. Yes, right, correct. So this is the stable, which is this one. This is the unstable, and this is the stable. Right? So between these two points, I mean, it depends where you start. If you start here, you end up here. If you start there, you end up there. So that's the same, but in two dimensions, right? In one, yeah. Any other question?
Can I ask?
Yes.
In the part where you have S species,
mm-hmm.
for the general. I didn't understand why you said for if there are S, so there will be S equations.
Yes.
There will be two S potential fixed points.
Yes. Okay. Yes. So, so why there are two to the S potential fixed points? So you have these equations here, right? And I minus sum over j, j, and j, right? When I want to solve this equation, there I have I want to solve this for every I, right? Now let's talk informally first. So I can solve this setting this equal to zero or this equal to zero for every I, right? If you take one I, right, this can be zero or this cannot be zero. Said in a different way, if I have to solve this equation and I have S species, I can think of whether for each species whether it's going to be present or absent. Right? So more formally, I can say I have all my species and I can define a set, a subset of species, let's say S, okay? And if I belongs to S, that species is present. So Ni star is larger than zero, okay? And if I does not belong to this set, Ni star is equal to zero, okay? So this fixed point here, these solutions here, are the solutions of Ri equal to sum over j in S, Aij, nj star, okay? Which in general, if this matrix is invertible, are nj star equal to the sum over k, a minus 1, jk, rk, okay? So you see that when I do this, here I'm summing only over the k in S. So this is an equation only for the I in S. Right? This is not a sum over all the system. Is I have my matrix A, I choose a subsystem, and this is the matrix I'm inverting here. Right? So this inverse actually is the, this is like a sort of misleading in some sense. This inverse is the inverse of the submatrix where I keep only the indices of the species that are present. Okay? Now, despite these complications, how many choices do I have in choosing a given number of species present and given number of species absent? Right? I have my list of species, and for each species, I have two choices. You are present or you are absent. I have S species, I have 2 to the S choices. Okay? That's why I have 2 to the S potential fixed points. Ah, do all these 2 to the S potential fixed points exist? No. Typically, no. I mean, we don't know, but typically, no. Why they don't exist? Well, because some of them, if I try to solve this, I'll get that this number here is lower than zero. Okay? If I substitute the numbers here, I might get that this is lower than zero. And this is an unfeasible fixed point, which means that since I cannot start from minus 3 hippos, I'll never end up on a fixed point with minus 100 hippos. Right? This is one problem. The second problem is, even if this fixed point exists, then that might be unstable, right? So, cool, I have something that potentially exists, but then is not stable and therefore is not going to persist over time. So the question is, if I have this system of equation and I start from some initial condition, chosen however you want, where do I end up, right? This is the problem of our, well, not life, but the problem of our class, right? If you start from some initial condition, well, it's also the problem of our life in some sense, but if you start from some initial condition, where do you end up for large times, right? For our life is easy because we end up horizontal, but for this, sorry for the, but in this case, we don't know, right? So where do we end up? Now, the interesting point is when I have a system with that species, I can end up perhaps in many different points depending on the initial condition, or I can end up in one point independent of the initial condition. What I sort of showed you is that if this matrix here is symmetric, it exists a Lyapunov function, which is a convex function, which implies that independently of the initial condition, you end up, provided some conditions, you end up in the same fixed point. So if you simulate this equation and you choose this matrix, say, more or less however you want, let's say you don't fine-tune the parameters, you choose it however you want, you start from initial condition A, or you start from initial condition B, you integrate the dynamics, at the end you end up with the same subset of species that are going to be present, the same subset of species that are going to be extinct, and the ones that are going to be present with the same fixed point. If this is not symmetric, it's a whole completely different story. You start with some initial condition, and perhaps you end up with some species present and other absent. You start with different initial condition, you end up with a different subset. Okay? Because in one case you have instability. Okay.
Can you enlighten us why you always use potential?
I said the word potential now.
I mean in general.
But now I said the word potential, because if I said the word potential, I should kill myself here now. I should do a rakiri, right? No, I didn't do potentials. No, okay, thanks. What do I mean when I say potential?
When you always get the potential.
Ah. A potential, okay. Potential means that I have this equation, okay, and can I write this as minus the derivative of some function over I? If I can do this, it exists a potential V of x. End of the story. Does it always exist? No. How do you show that it does not always exist? Huh? Yes, so if, I mean, you can check that if a potential exists, this equation here, valid for every I, implies that dFi dxj is equal to dFj dxi. Now, these are function, not function evaluated at some point.
Yes.
So that for a potential to exist, these two quantities have to be the same, which is something that almost never happens. Okay? This is what a potential means. Potential is one thing, Lyapunov function is another thing. They are two very different things. Potential, very rare. Lyapunov function, rare but not so rare. Okay? So a Lyapunov function is a different story. Lyapunov function is a function. So if a potential exists, you can show that, just using that definition, you can show that dv dt is lower or equal than zero. So that if you have this potential, the value of a potential decreases over time during the dynamics. Okay? You can show, I mean, you can calculate this explicitly, you substitute this definition, and you end up that that's true. Okay? How do you do that? Like, what is dv dt? Is equal to the sum over I x dot d v dxi dt, and if you substitute the definition you get minus I dv dxi squared, which is always a non-positive function. Okay? So this is always lower or equal to zero. So if it exists a potential, it exists a Lyapunov function. And the Lyapunov function is the potential. Right? Now, you can have cases where a potential does not exist, but you can define a function L which is bounded from below, blah, 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 such that dn over dt is lower or equal than zero. Okay? The existence of a Riemann function largely simplifies your life in trying to find where do you end up when you start from an initial condition, because you end up where? In the minimum of this function, right? And as we will see in a couple of lectures from now, it will also implies that you can have only fixed points and not other fancy things that you could have. Okay? So the existence of a Lyapunov function largely controls the behavior of your system for large times. Can you always build this? No. No, you cannot always build this. Right? But the fact that you have something like this does not imply that you can write the dynamics like that. Right? These two things are, this is a stronger condition. This condition is sufficient but not necessary to have a Lyapunov function. Okay. Also, because like the distinction between a potential and a Lyapunov function, it's something that, a large percentage of physicists sort of get it always confused, are always confused. Because they sort of have, a Lyapunov function is just a potential. I mean, there is another fundamental difference that a potential, if it exists, is unique, right? It's unique up to a redefinition of parameters, up to an additive constant, right? If I take a potential, the only transformation I can do is something that doesn't affect the derivative, so to add a constant, right? I have my potential, I can always put it down or up and doesn't change anything, but that's the only thing I can do. A Lyapunov function, if I take any positive function of a Lyapunov function, it's a Lyapunov function. Suppose that L of x is a Lyapunov function, and positive increasing function, and I take g of L of x, right? Is this a Lyapunov function? Well, this is an arbitrary function here. Well, I can check, right? This is gonna be d, let's call this g of x, right? I can take g over dt is going to be equal to what?
It's
going to be equal to dg dl, sorry, dg dl dl dt, right? So, dg is more g. So if this is always, if the derivative is always positive, then I can see that this doesn't change the sign, right? So as long as I have a function which is always increasing, which is monotonically increasing, then, which has always a positive derivative, first derivative, then this function here is also a Lyapunov function, right? So you see that it's a much, much broader class, right? While here, if I have a potential, this is a potential only if this is a constant, right? And nothing else. This is a much, much broader class. And also, if this exists, is easy to construct. If this is exist, you don't have any rule to construct it. You have just to go to sleep and dream. Dream the form and be lucky. There is no constructive way to... if I give you a problem and I tell you construct the Lyapunov function, well, there is no method you can apply to do it. Right? And there is no method a priori to know whether it exists. Like the Holy Grail, in some sense, right? Other questions?
It's about the great Barrington definition.
Then? Sorry, I'm becoming.
Consensus?
Okay. Any other question about lecture 6? Yes.
The part where. You do the change of variables, so it's like you rescale the something. How do you, if it was me alone, I wouldn't know variables. So for example, for this, for the Lacta Volterra, is this like a given or they have a meaning?
Well, there is, no, I understand the question. So, I mean, in some sense, it doesn't matter, right? So, a rescaling of the variables is just a smart way to simplify your calculation, but it's not something that changes the result. Right?
Mm-hmm.
So, for instance, in that case of Lotte Volterra, we chose that reparametrization just because choosing that reparametrization, you basically remove all the parameters, right? But, I mean, if you don't do that, you reach exactly the same result with marginally more calculations. But it's not, something for those simple systems, doesn't play such a big role, right? Yes.
So that's why when you got the partial U over tau, and then later it became the, it's because of that.
Well, I mean, it's because sometimes I'm, I mean, I sort of mixed up the notation, but the point is, I mean, rescaling, the reason why we, the fundamental reason why we rescale the variable is because we don't, I mean, it's because the dynamical behavior for large times depends only on a few combination of parameters, right? So there are few effective parameters that matters, and we are trying to identify those. Therefore, for instance, regarding the time scale, if we care only about the large time limit, the time scale is really something we don't care about.
Right?
I mean, as long as it's a positive quantity, we don't care about that. So you can, I mean, in some sense, you can choose any parametrization you want, provided that you keep the sign correct, right? But there is no, I mean, it's not really something that I can tell you. I mean, at least I don't think I can come out quickly with a set of rules that tells you how to rescale parameters in general, right? So if I give you another equation, how do I choose the right reparametrization? Well, I'll try to do one and see whether it simplifies my calculation or not. Okay.
So
yes.
For example, for any system, it's trial and error.
Yeah, in some sense, it's trial. I mean, you have to do calculations, and every time you write a new line, you have to sort of rewrite many parameters, right? So you are trying to minimize the amount of ink you are using.
Yeah.
But it doesn't mean it's just I redefine these parameters in this way because then I can write fewer equations, right? Fewer terms.
Mm-hmm.
But you can also write all the terms and you end up with the same result. Right? So it's not really something that there is a right way to do it. No, it's a good question. I mean, it's one of those things that you sort of learn by doing, right? After a while, you develop a feeling of what is the proper way to rescale. But in some sense, you rescale the parameters in that way because you know that the answer depends only on the some combination of parameters. Good. Any other question on lecture 6? If not, we can move in the crazy world of epidemiology. So, I mean, I'm sorry because I uploaded lecture 7 earlier than Friday evening, but then I realized that there were like many long videos without audio. It was really frustrating for me and for whoever watched them without audio. But,
No,
great. But it's, yeah.
I watched it.
Okay. No, I mean, but, okay.
What do you mean?
Yeah, because I upload, I mean, the, okay, so did who watch lecture 7?
Okay,
so, do you want to, I mean, lecture 7 was about epidemiology.
Mm-hmm.
We can keep it for next time.
We can keep it for next week. Let's keep it for next week. Okay? I think it's better also because tomorrow you have something to do.
Ah, oh, yes.
Okay? So, I'll free you now. Great.
We also have our homework.
You also have the assignments, but for those you have, I mean, one important point about the homework assignments, you now have, I mean, of course tomorrow you have the exam, so, but, mm-hmm. And you probably feel that you have time for the homework assignment, so, it was like 4 weeks, you can say, well, 4 weeks, come on, 4 weeks is a long time, but really start to think about them early, yes.
Yes.
So about the summer school which you organize.
Yes.
In December.
Yes.
We will be in part or we have to...
Okay, so